I'd like to introduce our panelists for this afternoon. As I call your name, if you wouldn't mind coming up and taking a seat. First, we'll start with Rick Goldsmith. Rick has joined us all the way from sunny California. He has brought the sun with him. He is a renowned, anyone you'd like? Yeah? Renowned director and producer that you've heard more about earlier, and a fantastic storyteller. So thank you for telling this story. And we also have with us, I don't see her here. Oh! I'm expecting to see you in the back looking tall and wonderful. Chamique Holdsclaw. As you've seen and heard, Chamique is a renowned athlete, author, and advocate. Her story is very powerful, and it's universal, and it speaks to everyone who has faced adversity, and I'm sure everyone in this crowd has faced challenges. In her professional career as a basketball player, she is a three-time NCAA champion, player of the year with the Lady Volunteers at the University of Tennessee under the Pat Summitt. She also was the first-round draft pick in the WNBA draft in 1999, and a six-time WNBA All-Star throughout her professional career. Absolutely. In addition to her great accomplishments on the court, she's also been extremely successful off the court. Since 2007, she's been a public speaker and powerful mental health advocate. She has a passion for shining light on mental health issues, especially as they affect underrepresented groups, African Americans, and youth. She has spoken on topics such as overcoming obstacles, adversity, and leadership. She is also the published author of Chamique Holdsclaw, My Story, and Breaking Through, Beating the Odds One Shot at a Time. Thank you, Chamique. We're also very proud to partner on this screening with North Shore LIJ, who many of you know throughout Long Island. They do fantastic work. We're honored to partner with Stacy Rosen. Dr. Stacy Rosen is the Vice President of Women's Health for the Katz Institute for Women's Health. And as I understand it, Dr. Rosen, there will be a women's sports addition to the Institute.
Yep.
Wonderful. And we also have with us Dr. Brian Keefe, who's the acting medical director of Zucker Hillside Hospital that's within the North Shore LIJ system. Please welcome him. And finally, we have Joshua Steinversel, who is an orthopedic surgeon with the Department of Orthopedic Surgery and Orthopedic Sports Medicine from North Shore University Hospital. Thank you. So we'll have a wonderful, engaging discussion with this panel. I first would like to say that I'm very honored to even be a part of this, that you would tell this story that would address the issues of mental health. I think that if we all were to be honest in this room, at one point or another, many of us have struggled with adversity in different ways, and the response has been that we've become depressed. Or that we're struggling in some way mentally, and a lot of times we don't want to share about that because we feel as though we're going to be labeled somehow, and there's a stigma. But this film brings freedom because it addresses that there should not be a stigma, and that people should openly be able to say, I need help. And I would like to first start off just even having an understanding of how this story began with you, Rick, and Chamique. What was the genesis of this story?
I was looking for my next film. I'd worked on a lot of other documentaries, and I came across an article that you saw in the film by William Roden, the sports writer, about Chamique Holdsclaw, and I just thought it was a terrific topic because here was somebody who was well-known, a celebrity to many kind of different parts of the population, and wasn't afraid to speak out and reveal her own life, as it was demonstrated in that article, on, you know, in her speaking tour, sharing her own story. I also had mental illness in my own family with my uncle, who was a lifelong schizophrenic, and my daughter was struggling with emotional issues, and so it was very close to me, as I know it's close to a lot of people. I'm kind of known for tackling political issues, and to me, I felt like this is actually the most personal film I've done and most political film I've done, because I feel like it touches almost everyone and every family. So that was the germ of it, and Chamique's name, while she's quick to point out to me that I'm not a terrific women's basketball fan, it was still a familiar name to me, and it struck me that my old friend from Valley Stream, I grew up with Lon Babby, was her agent. All right, I thought that he might be, and I checked it out with him. I said, "Wasn't Chamique Holdsclaw your one of your clients?" And he said yes. And Lon went ahead and made the introduction. You saw Lon in the movie. So from my point of view, that was the germ of it. And then I knew I had to kind of talk to Chamique and see if this could possibly happen.
And of course, I was a little apprehensive at first, because here I am about to allow someone, into my life on a daily, someone following me around. Yes, I've spoke about my issues, but he was really going to portray my life in a really intimate way. So I was like, oh, I don't know about this. And then, he flew in town, we got to sit down and converse, and sooner or later, I'm like, okay, I like this guy. He started opening up about his family and his daughter, and I said, he's really passionate about this, and, I was like, hey, we can definitely come together and do this.
Thank you, and we're glad that you did.
Thank you.
And I'd also like to address Dr. Rosen from the Katz Women's Institute. If you could just share just your thoughts on how you'd like for this film to engage with the audience.
Oh, sure. Thanks, Erica. In years past, women's health was perceived as what we sometimes call the bikini approach, the parts of the body that are covered by a bikini, gynecologic organs and the breasts. And what's so important to me when I first saw this film is it really fits along our focus at Women's Health at North Shore LIJ, is that women's health is everything about a woman's individual health. And it is mental illness, it is heart disease, it is lung disease. And so much of what you see in the film about this magnificent woman who's sharing her story with us speaks to all women, the importance of staying strong, the part of the story where Chamique was the last to take care of herself while caring for her brother and, other family members. And that's such an important line that goes along all of the way we approach women's health, that women put themselves last. Their needs for preventing disease or staying healthy are often something that they're reluctant or shy or embarrassed to speak about. So for us, this is our third year participating, and this film just sort of says it all as far as our vision and mission goes. Thanks.
Thank you. Dr. Steinversel, as an orthopedic surgeon, how does this apply when, we're talking about how athletes are expected to have this, they have this burden of having to present themselves as everything's okay, and if you don't present that image, then if you show any vulnerability, that means weakness. And in your profession, you come into athletes who have endured injuries, and sometimes it's career ending, and that brings them to a place where they have to make decisions that are sometimes overwhelming. Can you share a bit about how you like to talk about this film?
Right. Well, that's a big, difficult thing for a lot of athletes to go through. When you think about these people, whether it's college or even professional, they put so much effort into the sport and practice and their whole life dedicated to this one thing, and it really becomes your whole identity. And when you have a significant injury where that basically takes away you know, your whole purpose of being, it's very difficult. So, you know, it's important that people have, you know, some balance in their life, you know, in order to be able to cope, you know, once you get to that point.
Thank you. And Dr. Keith, we're actually going to end this part of chatting, and then we'll move on to engaging with you. But if you could share final thoughts as well.
Thank you. I just want to say it's a pleasure to be here, and I appreciate the opportunity to be invited and talk about this important topic. I'm the medical director at Zucker Hillside Hospital, part of the North Shore LIJ network, and we take care of literally thousands of patients with depression and bipolar disorder every year. And I think what I was struck with most in this particular film was a sort of reinforcement of the idea of the stigma of mental illness, especially in athletes, and the idea that if one presented oneself as mentally ill to their local community, they would be could be perceived as being weak. And I guess I just wanted to reinforce the idea also that that it was remarkable that Chamique was driving that one night and was wondering if she were to kill herself, would anybody miss her? And this is despite the idea of having thousands of fans, a supportive family, supportive friends. It really shows us just how where mental illness can take us and where it can lead. And I guess I was struck by that.
Thank you. Rick, would you like to say any more in terms of addressing the audience?
I would like to open it up, but okay. I did just want to say one personal note that my first professional experience in the mental health world was at Long Island Jewish Hillside Hospital in 1972. I was a psychiatric aide there and worked there for 2 years. And I joke, you know, when you're an artist, when you're a filmmaker, it's like, you know, really have a real job. I always say, well, that was my last real job. Anyway, so thank you for continuing with that work, all of you on the panel.
Great. I will be walking around with the microphone, and we can start with questions for our great panel in the back.
Hi, my name is Michael, and like you, Ms. Holdsclaw, I am bipolar and PTSD, and have been treated successfully now for about 25 years. And as you know, it's an ongoing, exquisitely difficult process every day. One of the things that I have to encounter, and I didn't hear mentioned here, is do you ever struggle with knowing when your depression or elation, I don't want to call it mania, elation is in fact an appropriate response to what's going on in your life, and not the disease at work?
It is something that I struggle with, because sometimes when I tell my friends, I feel myself reaching these different highs, you know? And I ask myself, is this what I'm normally supposed to feel? Is this supposed to be my reaction, or is this my illness? So I'm constantly, you know, I guess I want to say in conflict. Like, I'm trying to figure it out. So it's something that I go through also. And I'm like, okay, like, all right, this happened. So this should be natural, you know? So I kind of talk myself through it, trying to process everything. Never. It never ends. And, you know, a lot of people, because, you know, the work that I do and I'm out in the community and traveling, people want to think that you're healed. And I'm the first to say, you know, this is something that I live with. You know, this is an illness, this is a disorder, and I have to, you know, take care of myself. I have to make sure that I take my medications. I have to make sure if I need therapy that I go to therapy. It's ongoing, but I know if I do the work, if I do those things, that I can live a healthy lifestyle, and, you know, that's what I'm doing.
Every time I see my psychiatrist, I come home, the first question my wife asks me is, are you cured? Not yet.
Well, thanks for sharing, and I wish you the best.
Thank you.
All right.
Hi, my name is George, and this movie really got to me in a lot of ways. I have the same condition you have, and also to see this gentleman from Hillside Hospital. My mother worked there for 30 years as a therapist, but now she's 89 years old, and she stays in her apartment and drinks, and so it's a covers all the, you know, all the gamuts in my life. And and I just wanted to say that for all the struggles that I've gone through with it and drinking also, in a certain way, I'm kind of grateful that I have it, because it opened up the world to me. I mean, look at you. You were going to drive into a tree, and then look what's happened. You know, it's an awareness, basically, that no one has unless they have the problem. And it's actually very a valuable and wonderful awareness to have, and I thank you so much for sharing your story with us.
Thanks, George. And to piggyback what George said, I always been a very confident person. I'm a competitive athlete, but I think, you know, I was suffering in silence for so long, so when I finally came out and admitted to it, it was like I was finally walking in my truth. I even became more confident in who I was as a person. I was no longer hiding. And in that, you know, dealing with my issues even made me more compassionate for other people's and other people's struggles. So it's really just, you know, just transformed my life in a way.
Hi, do I stand up? Other people stood up. Two things I guess I'm interested in. I don't know why I have the sunglasses on. I was listening in the beginning to how you picked that college. And the fact that your grandmother said, well, 100% graduation rate. And I think about how it seems the guy basketball players don't pick the colleges based on those criteria, and they get totally utilized by the system. So I think you were very lucky to have had someone who just said that. And maybe women are lucky because they don't have the same pressures that I'm assuming that the NBA puts on. But is there something that, do you feel that you might have a role to play, or is there something we can do to sort of help, to me, these student athletes that are then, I think, are more likely to be exploited by the colleges they go to? They tend to get injured, presumably, and they're not given an opportunity to graduate. They don't presumably get, they don't have representation because there's no union, and they don't get medical care and everything that they should get after they've sacrificed everything for their college. So I know it's totally on a tangent, but...
No, you made a great point, and you said a key word, student athletes. You're a student first, and it starts from the grassroots. You know, the coach that first coached me was like, hey, you know, I want you to go to Stanford. I want you to go to this school. You're a great basketball player, but you can go to any college you want to. My high school coach, who's in attendance, the same thing, was academics first. You know, when I wasn't doing well in school, it's like, okay, you know, I'm going to sit you out if you're not going to take care of business, you know, in a classroom. And then I go home, and my grandmother was like, you know, like kind of psycho about it, you know, schoolwork, schoolwork, schoolwork. And so that was instilled in me for day one. And I go to college, it's the same thing. So I was lucky to have those people that, you know, stress academics. And so I was going to be both, you know, I was going to take care of business. But if you, nowadays, if you tell these kids, oh, you're great, and constantly promote basketball, you know, these kids now aren't even passing their SATs. You know, they're thinking they can go straight overseas. You know, they're having people take exams for them, and they're not doing well. You know, life is hard, right? Life is very hard. And so sometimes you just got to put the work into it. And I think a lot of times these coaches now giving these kids these shortcuts, and then they run into real difficulties in life, and they're not prepared at all.
Just to also talk to your point. If you look at the numbers on graduation rates for kids and student athletes, the female student athletes do in general have a higher graduation rate than the men. If you look at, I think it was, I forgot what year, but recently, like the Sweet 16, teams, it was almost all of them had 100% graduation rate for the women's team, and the men's was significantly lower. But overall, in terms of kids in sports, the kids do better academically who participate in sports compared to the kids who don't. So there are a lot of positives, with sports participation. It does help kids, self-esteem and confidence. In Shamiqua's case, it actually probably treated your depression with sports in a way, focused on that, and it does, give you an elevated mood. So there is a lot of positivity to playing sports. Not, at a certain level, it can be a little exploitative, but overall, it's a good thing.
Do I gotta stand up like everybody else? I'll stand up. Why not? A couple of things. One, my name is Mark. Shamika, we met a long, 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 long time ago. We probably don't even remember that. It was at Christ the King, but anyway. In the film, you had said a couple of things, and I'm going to have a bunch of questions, so stay close in this area. you said this disorder helped fuel how good you were because you were able to, I guess, lose yourself and obtain a high that helped you perform on the court. When dealing with, because I deal with a bunch of young women that aspire to play college basketball and things like that, when dealing with them, is it a certain thing that coaches can identify to say, okay, this kid is doing such a great job, but is there more? Because also, too, you said that high took you to great heights and things like that, but ultimately, I don't want to say nobody cared, but nobody shed the light until you actually hit rock bottom. So it was a situation where everything that you were doing, nobody highlighted it. But as soon as Shamika wasn't Shamika and she fell off that pedestal, so to speak, now it's what's going on. Was there something or is there something that can be done to help identify that same type of thing or pattern in a kid to where you can identify it and then possibly push them in a direction so that they can ultimately get the help and treatment that they need?
Well, that was my personal experience. And, I just know when I coach kids, the way I look at it is I try to really listen to them. I'm not a professional. I'm not a psychologist. I'm not, studying these kids. But, they have a lot of issues and pressures that they're dealing with, from being bullied to having issues in their homes. And I think sometimes, we want them out there to compete and play. But I'm more concerned, and that's me personally. Again, I'm more concerned, how are you doing in school? Hey, do you want to talk about something? And that's my approach. And that's why I probably will never be a successful college coach, because I know that the great ones, the Gina Oriamas, the Pat Summit, those is very few coaches that can balance caring and also being that competitive. I have friends that have played for other programs, and the coaches don't care. They graduate and it's like out the door, And so again, that's my personal experience, and this is why I haven't been coaching yet, because I would really care. When I'm dealing with a kid that family doesn't have anything to eat, and they're at the university, they're struggling, I would want to go in my pockets and give them some money, but again, that's a violation. So it's just really tough. It's just really tough when you're dealing with so many issues that these kids have, and I'm sure one of these people up here will have some more to say on the topic.
I can speak to this for a minute. Number one, she's an extraordinary basketball player, and she has bipolar disorder. I just want to be clear, it's not because of that. She has extraordinary concentration, extraordinary grit, and has spent her life developing an immense talent. And I think that I just want to be clear about that. And the bipolar disorder, although part of your certainly part of your life and part of your every day, she's a shining example of how someone who stays in treatment can go on to do wonderful things. And the second thing I would say is about what to do or how to identify these folks that you're working with, these girls that you're working with. I think the The best thing to do is not to try to diagnose them or try to push them to help, but to listen. Because you're the first person many of them are going to come to it with their troubles. And I think if you keep your ears open they trust you, they respect you, they look up to you, you're the person that will make a profound difference in their life. If and when they start talking about things like self-harm or really start to show as if they're getting into trouble with safety, that's when you bring them to help.
I'd like to add a couple of things. First of all, to correct any misconception, I think that sports is and especially youth sports is a tremendous, tremendous thing for kids, both just to help them grow and psychologically and everything. And I think there's just different approaches. And I knew immediately after getting to know Vince Canizzaro, who's in the audience, who was up on screen here. Chamique was
over there,
and Vince. Thank you. Thank you for all your great work, past and present. And, I wish I could put more of Vince's interview onto the screen. But, one of the things he said, he really emphasized is, a lot of, especially high school coaches, they're not really trained in a lot of things that have to do with kind of psychological preparation. And he's certainly somebody who's stressed it, but also thinks that it's really important for coaches to be aware of that. So in every sports program, there's coaches and medical personnel that are on the beam and pushing people, in the right direction, like, Coach Summit and everything. And there are others that aren't so good. And one other thing that I'd like to point out, because with this film, we're approaching a lot of different venues, and one is sports psychologists. And there's a dichotomy, what I'm learning now, kind of new, but now I'm learning from talking with sports, there's a real dichotomy among sports psychologists and a lot of big time programs, whether they're college or even the pros. Sports psychology means, how can we get you to perform better for the team? And that's, the downside of it, because it's at the expense often of the person. And there's the other side of sports psychology, the really good ones who are predominantly psychologists and think in terms of what's best for this person. And is this person, if they're, struggling, how can we help him or her work on those issues?
And it made me feel like, I was making something up and this didn't really exist. So did you ever feel along the way that you had to go to someone who could relate to your struggle? And then for the doc, have you ever run into something like that, and how did you handle it?
Well, we should describe it to Dina. Dina's a good friend of mine and a journalist with ESPN. And we've had a lot of time to kind of talk about, our mental health issues. She was living in Atlanta. And what I find out, a lot of men are like that. Like, a lot of the male athletes that I've talked to, they're like, man, they don't understand where I'm coming from. I can't really deal with them. I thought like that for a while, and I tried different therapists. I'm like, she doesn't understand me. I'm thinking, okay, I need someone black or, maybe understands where I grew up to be able to talk to me, to understand my journey. But you know what? I ended up with a 55-year-old white woman from the country in Georgia. And it was because she really listened, and she allowed me to really express myself. Of course she told me like it was, and she would say, hey, Shamique, this is in your head. And sooner or later, I realized, this is the one. You are the one for me. Because I always tell these younger kids, they're like, and when I'm at the colleges, oh my God, I tried this therapist, I don't like her. You have to really choose your therapist like you're gonna choose, I say, your husband or somebody. You got, if it doesn't work for you, you're dating someone, you gotta get rid of them. And you gotta go to the next one, and if that doesn't work, get rid of them again. And so there's somebody that you feel this closeness and this connectivity to.
Switch out anything, but they're embarrassed to switch docs. And so much of what you're hearing is about two things: empowering each of us as individuals to listen to what's wrong, Women, I think, a little better than men, have this small voice inside that really tells them when something's not right. You should always listen to that voice. And on the flip side, we all need to be really good listeners with our friends and family, because if something doesn't seem right, that's often an opportunity to identify conditions that otherwise can really lose an opportunity to be prevented or treated earlier. I think you saw all of that in the film.
I think you're raising a very interesting point, an interesting question. As someone who used to run a training program, something my residents used to ask me all the time about goodness and fit and match in psychotherapy. And I guess I was underscoring what's already been said, that it really is about goodness and fit, not about what the person across from you looks like. Therapists are hired co-investigators, so their job is to sort of sit with you and help you investigate how you got to this point and how you can navigate through it and potentially out of it. And I think that you should be with the person who you feel most comfortable with sitting next to you in that car, and the person that you feel most comfortable talking with.
And you know what though? I got kicked out of therapy. seriously, because maybe you can answer this. Like my therapist was telling me, like, you know, I kind of had really changed a lot. When I first came in there, I was like on the edge, you know, at the tip of my seat. And then, you know, months and months and months, a year later, I'm sitting back and we're just having such relaxed conversation. And she said, you can't become like codependent. You know, you have to learn to take these skills that I've been taught, the cognitive behaviors, and take them out and try to really function on your own. And she goes, I don't want to see you here for a couple months. Like, go and try to learn how to practice these coping mechanisms on your own. I mean, do you see that a lot? Because some people, she said, will stay in therapy just to stay there as a crutch. I'm asking you, you're the professional.
I signed up for this only to take questions from the audience. So there's a fine line between co-investigation, right, and dependency, right? And there, you know, 30 years ago there was a belief in mostly universal in the mental health field that you need to sort of bring someone in, break them down, help them sort of foster that sort of childlike dependency in order to get them better. That is not the case any longer. There are certain types of illnesses and issues for which that's still relevant, but for the most part now, we think of healing as something that takes place out there and not in the consultant's office. The remove, repair, and replace model has kind of been exchanged for how can we help you find these resources within yourself? Because, you know, most of the problems people face when they get into trouble with illness or whatever are based on stressors that happen outside the therapist's office. So.
Hello, my name is Ruth. First of all, I want to thank you for this film. It is excellent, really excellent. And second of all, Chamique, not only are you extremely talented as a basketball player, I'm not good at sports at all. I went to an all-girls junior high school, and my best friend and I were always the last one picked for the basketball, the volleyball, because I was afraid of the ball. I was afraid the ball would hit me. So that's one thing. But you are obviously extremely intelligent. Extremely intelligent. You want to hear me? Okay. I'm a retired teacher, and I'm a little hard of hearing, so I'm always concerned with people hearing me. But what I wanted to say is, I have mental illness in my family, a very close member of my family. And it's not only bipolar and not only depression, but there's also schizophrenia, which is also a very, very serious illness and can really affect a person's life very badly, as well as the family. And I'm very active in an organization that I hope you know about, NAMI. Are you familiar with NAMI? It's the National Alliance on Mental Illness, and it has over 1,100 chapters in the United States alone. And I would imagine that the head of Hillside, Zucker Hillside, must know it very well. And I just want to say NAMI, aside from everything else, fights the stigma. because not only is mental illness, any mental illness, very, very difficult, just as cancer and diabetes and the other illnesses, but you also have the stigma, which is so terrible, so difficult. So I'm hoping that maybe we can get you to come and speak to Mary once, because you are a wonderful speaker, and everybody would identify with you. And I'm on the board of NAMI Queens Nassau, so we meet at Zucker Hillside Hospital. So, okay, thank you very much again.
Thank you.
I do believe, were you ever part or took part in the Women's National Sports Foundation Black Tie Gala in New York City?
No, I've actually was invited like a bunch of times, but I was always like overseas playing basketball.
I would have met you.
Yeah, Yolanda, you said, yeah, Miss Yolanda Johnson, I think, was the...
Yes,
was the former executive director.
With that, I found out, being a volunteer, I used to pick up the athletes from the airports and bring them into New York City. And what I found extremely supportive for the women is that it was a three-day weekend, and they were trained as far as what could happen. And there was a panel of women, professional women, who did outstandingly well in sports and college, to enlighten the new ones that are doing well as what could happen to them. And I found out that to be a female professional athlete, they had to graduate first from college, which I do believe men do not have to do. So, and the theory was, if you had an injury, you always had your education to fall back on. So that's one reason why I do believe women are doing far better as far as education, is they can't become a professional athlete until they do graduate from college. The other question I have for you is, when you were in high school, junior high school, and you were starting to do extremely well athletically, in your school, did they have guidance counselors that were really guidance counselors, as to opposed to just scheduling you for your classes for the following year?
Oh yeah, of course. You're sitting next to the man right there, Mr. C. Grab the mic. Tell him how you. You can tell him, Mr. Kinzer. I mean, this is my high school coach, and he ran a tight ship, so he can explain how things went down. These are my mates right here, so y'all know how things went. Study hall, on time, 2 hours before practice, and we're like focused there studying, and I mean, we didn't take fake classes, we really took tough classes.
No, my question is, did you have school psychologists that any kid that was having problems could come in and just talk to them?
You, what I want to say, it was a different time. It was a different time, you know. It was back then and there. I mean, you had coaches that were really hands-on, you know, very hands-on, ran the programs. They knew everything that was going on. We were such a tight-knit group. I mean, we did everything together. I used to go to this girl's house to eat like every day after school. So if something was going on, you know, everybody knew. We shared so much. Times are different now, you know, with so many distractions, you know, kids are not the same. So, you know, Mr. Canizero was able to have his hand in on everything because we were just so close. So we didn't need, at that time, a school psychiatrist or a guidance counselor. I mean, it was the coaches did everything, and we were lucky to have someone that can oversee it.
Well, getting on to that, I guess, at Christ the King, we ran the program as if it was a college program. Every player was programmed into the computers at the school, and the guidance counselors knew what they were doing academically. And as Chamique just said, the team practiced every day, and before they could practice, they had to go to study hall. Nobody went home, and we weren't worried about them doing homework at home because they've already done it. The guidance counselors in any high school are not trained psychologists. They're basically guidance counselors. If we had or saw a problem, we would immediately have the guidance counselors know about it, and they would be able to direct that student and their family to someone who could help them. But there is no high school around that, you know, can have trained psychologists as guidance counselors. One of the things that we pride ourselves on is that every year, in 19 years that I was at Christ the King, every athlete that played for us was academically eligible to graduate on 4 years and go to college. We never had one that wasn't academically eligible. That's why we kept an eye on her.
Hi, my name is John, and my question is, I know Chamique mentioned in the film several times that you thought you were the only person with this illness out there, and my question is, do you see a role for spirituality or the 12-step programs in your recovery? The question is put to not only Chamique, but all the panelists. Because there is an organization called Emotions Anonymous. I'm not trying to, of course, knock therapists or medication, but as a supplement to those things. And thank you for an excellent program. And film.
I can speak to this. I'm very familiar with the 12-step programs, and I think they've worked for tens of thousands of people. They don't work for everybody, as you say, but they're perhaps most important in terms of making a person feel less alone. You get together every week or even more than once a week with a group of people who suffer with the same issues that you're coming to the group with. So in that instance, it's very valuable for thousands and thousands of people. There's also a peer movement in the treatment of serious mental illness now, the so-called peer movement, where patients with illnesses in recovery are being trained, are coming onto our inpatient units, are working in outpatient running groups to address also this issue.
Yeah, thank you. My name's Gary. I love your movie. Thank you. I also grew up in Astoria, so that's fantastic. I used to play softball in the same projects, Astoria House. In one part of the movie, you talked about drinking, and you started to drink and stuff like that. Then I didn't see it anymore. So it was similar to his question was, obviously, I guess you addressed that issue, because I don't think alcoholism or drinking goes with mental illness. It's also for the doctor. And obviously, mental illness doesn't go with drinking, so... Can drinking too much probably bring exacerbate the mental illness, and can the mental illness also bring on the drink more drinking? If you know what the question is.
I think I understand what you're saying. Alcohol and drug misuse and mental illness go hand in hand in many instances, especially mood disorders and especially bipolar disorder. In fact, the most common comorbidity, the most common condition associated with bipolar disorder is substance use disorder. Yes, unfortunately, it's a reciprocal relationship, and many people tend to use more when they're feeling down, uncomfortable, or on the other side, hyperactive and grandiose. So people use different substances depending on mood state, but they're in those two run together, unfortunately, all too commonly.
Yeah, and he's right. You reach that point where you're so high and you just want something to kind of calm you down. But I mean, I know that I can't drink like that because I look at my family history and I knew that would be all bad. So I just really just tried to focus on fitness and different things to kind of take my mind after. But it was a point where I'm like, man, I'm partying a lot, you know? But then, like I said, I think about my family, my mom and stuff, and I couldn't go that path.
Hi, my name is Taj Paxton, and my question is for Chamique and the panel, and then a separate question for Rick. First of all, the film is excellent, thank you. And my question is about relating to your passion. So I have a similar story in that I had undiagnosed depression for about 20 years. And one of the ways it manifested was that I was also very good at my work and excelled, and then hit rock bottom. So now I find as I relate to my work, I don't trust the passion because it leads to a level of intensity that I'm not sure I'm always able to manage. It feels like it will overtake me, so I kind of have a trouble relating to it healthily. I'm just concerned about it. So I wonder if you experience that now after having channeled your passion into basketball and into such a level of excellence. When you're now looking at where your life is heading, do you have that relationship to it as well?
Oh, I definitely agree, because I'm one of those people where I realize if I find something that I enjoy, I go all in. And it kind of scares me, because I'm like, okay, is this like my illness? Am I attaching to something else to kind of cope with it? So I have to like really, you know, I journal, I try to write things down, but that is something, like I just attach to things. If I enjoy bike riding, this is my new hobby. I'm going all out, helmet, new bike, new shoes. And I'm like, it's almost picking up a new addiction. So I just have to really just like, hey, you know, calm down. Let me really think about this.
And to the panel, in terms of how you relate to clients who might be experiencing that, do you have something you share with them, or CBT techniques or something like that?
I guess there's a hierarchy of coping mechanisms for bad feeling states, right? And it's a heck of a lot better to play basketball than it is to drink a fifth of whiskey, and it's a heck of a lot better to pursue excellence in your work than it is to blow coke. But I guess the only time you know your passion is too passionate is when other people around you are saying, your family says they miss you, they don't see you, or your friends say they miss you when they don't see you. Oftentimes, we it's best when we take our cues from the people that love us and listen to what they have to say.
And then the final question is for Rick, in terms of filmmaking. Your subjects have been so different, and every filmmaker kind of takes a journey with a film and it changes them. I'm just curious, because your passion for this film is so evident, how has this film taken you on a journey, and what have you learned from it?
Well, you know, I mentioned at the beginning that my daughter was struggling with a lot of emotional issues. She was 14 when I started this film, and I'm going to take a slight detour here. One night we had the film showed in San Francisco, and Chamique was there for that, and that's where I live. And I told the story that this was in my family, and mentioned my uncle, and my daughter came up to me after the movie, because she was in there. And she says, well, how come you didn't talk about me? And I said, well, gee, I didn't think it was really up to me to tell your story, and that's really pretty personal. And after we talked for a few minutes, she said, well, if you have any more of these Q&As, you can talk about me. So that's why I'm talking about her, if you're wondering, because it is pretty personal. And the next night, we showed it again in the Bay Area in Berkeley, and she was in the audience, and I told that story like I'm telling it to you, and you know, everybody applauded her. And it was a great moment for me. Now, I have to say, in the intervening 3 years between when I started the program and that night, I was dealing with being a father of an emerging young woman who was dealing with a lot of issues. And I think one of the things that came up most for her was, Dad, listen to me. You're not listening to me. And I hope through the journey of just, I mean, when you do interviews with people, it's your job to listen to them, but it's, you know, it's one thing's a job. And I felt like the journey of kind of listening to Chamique each time we talked on the phone, or each time I sat her down for an interview, and kind of watching what she went through, and bouncing back to my personal life, I think, I hope, that an important change took place in me, and that was the ability to listen, the availability, you know, when you're an adult, and maybe especially a man, you're encouraged to be more in charge today than you were yesterday, and more in charge the next day, until, like, you're at the top of your profession, you're in charge. And it's hard to balance that expectation with learning to listen. So, I don't know, I think anymore I could say what I'd be repeating myself, but I think, I hope, that that's the way I changed and that's the way I grew during the 3 years of being very good question.
Simona Marchelli, a therapist in Southern Hillside Hospital, and I am just overwhelmed with gratitude to you for this beautiful documentary and for you for sharing your story. I thought something really important that you pointed at different times during the documentary is the transitions. And as parents and as friends, I think it's important that we look into them, what things trigger our friends. You said you went from Christ the King, which is a fabulous school that we all know about, and you went to go to the University of Tennessee and deal with a fabulous coach that is a legend.
And then you went to the pros, and then your support system changed so much. The investment that all the other players were doing, they weren't, we're not going to say all of them, but they were trying to get paid. There was not that team, we're going to win, we're going to bring this back home. And that is one of the things maybe that you were also missing when the situation in the pros came about, when you had 3 years of people passing away or your friends not necessarily being there for you in those specific moments. Have you, and I have a question, have you gotten better at seeing your triggers, finding your fit? And from what you say in the documentary, you have. You were able to walk away from the pros and being like, I need to do me, I can help other children. How was that process for you?
You know, I've just really had this like whole maturation process just hit me, you know, when I went through my struggles, and it's just really just living, you know, living and just doing my best to enjoy life. I used to, you know, be like just so high, like full of energy, and I think, you know, maybe it's the medication, I don't know, but I'm just like really, really calm, and I just realized like life is full of like different transitions, and what I'm putting in my mind is like, I got to be ready to ride the waves. You know, something's gonna happen. Hey, it's gonna, I've realized from my experiences, I've been so high and you hit the ground, but guess what? I always bounce back up. You know, I know that I'm a person that's resilient. I know I'm a person that's persistent, and it always seems to work out for me. So I just try to, you know, not stress about things, because I think I'm a perfectionist. You know, I want things to always turn out a certain way, and I used to like stress about things, and I've just really just changed. And my friends are like, man, like nothing really bothers you. I'm like, why? I mean, I can't control certain things. Why am I going to stress? And I think once I started to just really think this way, I just saw how much I've just changed, and things got better for me.
My name is Michelle. I'm a physical therapist and an athletic trainer. And I had a kind of a question on something that you said, Chamique, like back in the day when everybody kind of was in high school athletics, it was like a team, it was a family. Nowadays, these kids are playing 3, 4, 5 different teams where they kind of get lost a little bit from their coaches. And dealing with these kids, do you guys have any advice or any maybe things that we can look at if they're, we're seeing them more than anybody 3 times a week in the clinic or on the field, they're hurt, they're not playing, you know, they're worried about, I have this showcase this weekend, but I sprained my ankle 7 days ago, how am I going to play in this showcase? You know, things that maybe we can kind of see that